Very good evening to all of you. This is Tej Kiran, and on behalf of Extra Mural Lectures team, I welcome you all to the newest session of the EML 2015-16 series. Today, we have with us a very distinguished guest, Ms. Anu Hasan. Ms. Anu Hasan is an actor, TV anchor, writer, and producer who has graduated from BITS Pilani with a dual masters in physics and management. She presented Tamil Nadu's most successful celebrity talk show to date, Coffee with Anu. She is known as Namma Anu after the show today. She's also hosted and presented En Samayal Ariyal, which is a cookery show, in addition to hosting a lot of reality shows. She won a state award for her supporting role in the movie Run, and she is also a recipient of the Kalaima Mani Award from the state government of Tamil Nadu. Ms. Anu Hasan has established and run a marketing company, juice and smoothie store, and her media career spans six languages and two countries. She is currently the European Director of IV Mobility, a world leader in digital value chains. I now call upon Professor Preeti Agalyam, the faculty advisor of Extra Mural Lectures, to welcome our speaker with a fruit basket. Thank you, ma'am. I would now request Ms. Anu Hasan to deliver her much-awaited talk on the power of conversations.
Graphics card not configured. I myself not configured. So, this is the one to change it, right? Which one is it? Okay, it's not. But this is change, right? No, I'm changing slides just that, right? Good evening to everybody. I thought first I would start off by saying, you know, the usual starting line, which is, thank you very much for this opportunity, but I could almost hear the collective groan that would rise from the audience. So I decided, no, let me not do it this way. Let me do it differently. And thank you all in the end, because anyway, at the end, I have to thank you for having sat through my talk, right? And it would be more meaningful. So I'll thank you all in the end. And of course, you can stop me at any time you want. To ask questions. The only thing is, I hope I don't lose the plot because I've been known to do that, but it won't be the first time and it won't be the last time. So I'm sure that, you know, we'll somehow, you know, I'll bumble forward and try and make sense of what I'm trying to tell you. So my life is like most people. I've done quite a lot of things, but I am known for one of the most unexpected things, which was Coffee with Anu. And Coffee with Anu was something that happened really unexpectedly. I was actually called to be a guest on the show. And then they called me and they said, can you be the host on the show? So it was like, okay, that's interesting, fine. And you know, personally, I thought Coffee was a fabulous experience because I was interacting with people from such diverse walks of life and highly successful people. And how many people get that opportunity, right? I mean, to be able to sit and have a one-on-one conversation with people who have achieved so much, I thought it was great fun. But even when I was doing Coffee, I was kind of bewildered as to why people liked it so much. So I was like, what are we doing? I mean, I'm not doing anything different. I'm just talking, which is what I do a lot, unfortunately. And you know, people also talk, so what's the big deal? So it was only after that I did Coffee that I realized, you know, what the amazing lessons that I had learned and the skills that I had honed while doing coffee. And more importantly, in my role in the corporate world, these lessons proved invaluable. So over the span of more than 4 years, I was interacting, and I do use the word interacting and not interviewing. So I was interacting with, I think, more than 500, maybe more than 500 people from really various walks of life. So we had people from the film industry, we had politicians, we had writers, sports guys, we had businessmen. So I was interacting with all of them. And while being a Hasan, you know, meant that I should know about movies, should. When it came to other areas, I had no qualms about accepting that I did not know. And therein lies my first lesson. So it actually turns out that it was one of my biggest advantages. The fact that I didn't know something meant that I was willing to learn about it. Because, see, normally what happens is we are nervous, isn't it, about appearing uninformed. And the first instinct for anybody is to try and bluster their way through and pretend I know. And you, though some in one corner, we would have seen something on the internet, we'd have picked up one line and we'll try to use it to our advantage and say, I know this, right? I'll put up my hand and say, I've done it as well. But I have failed more often than succeeded at it. Because it is very, very rare that people will not see through bluster. So what do? I tend to do my homework. And I try and get as much information as I can before I go for a meeting. This is when I'm in the corporate world. So I am also in the corporate world. And what happens is, I am constantly reminding myself that, yes, I've done my homework, but it's highly unlikely that I will know everything that there is. So I am going to have to ask questions. So if you can ask genuinely intelligent questions, which anyway for IIT students, it's baya haath ka khel, no? So if you can ask genuinely intelligent questions, you will come across as actively engaged, as honest in your approach, and also you'll end up learning much more because you're open. But there is a corollary. If you don't prepare and you say, baya haath ka khel, and go and try and ask questions, then I have seen that it doesn't make as good an impression because they can make out that you're not prepared. And that brings us to the next very, very important part of having a conversation. Okay, you've asked your questions. What then? You have to listen. And I cannot emphasize the importance of listening. And many people tell me that the reason that at the end of coffee, why they have spoken so much is because they thought I was listening, which is true. It's not that they thought I was. Yeah. So, you know, they felt that they were listened to, and so they were talking to me. And it is important that you're switched on when you're listening. Because, I don't know, are you all familiar with Coffee with Anu? I'm just making a great assumption that everyone knows what Coffee with Anu is. Yeah? Okay, Coffee with Anu was a celebrity talk show, and it was modeled along the lines of Coffee with Karan. So we used to invite celebrities from various walks of life to come and talk to us. The thing is, we had made some cultural changes in the show because we are South Indian, right? So we do not ask questions like they do in the North. I think you understand. So we had this really nice, very sweet, happy, positive kind of a talk show. So we used to have all this, talk about their childhood, talk about their memories, talk about their projects and things like that. So, and it did rather well because people wanted to be on the show because they had the safety net that they are not going to be embarrassed. Yeah. I mean, come on, wouldn't you go on a show if you knew you wouldn't be embarrassed? Yes, but, well, I am not that clever. I tend to put myself in places where I know I'll be embarrassed and, okay, fine, live and learn. But so what happens is when you're listening, it kind of makes it more conducive for people to talk more and more. And when you're listening to one person, like Coffee with Anu, as I was telling you, is a celebrity talk show, right? So if there was one person, it's easy. You just focus on that one person. You know what they're saying, you focus on them. But it gets a little bit more challenging in Coffee because we used to have sometimes two people, three. Then we've had 10 people coming. I still remember, you know, when the Chennai, there was a film called Chennai 28 that was made, and we had all of them come on the show. There was these young guys about in their 20s. We had about 8 of them on the set, and you can imagine it was absolutely raucous. There's a total noise happening, each one shouting and talking over the other. And I'm like trying to make some kind of sense out of what's happening. So I did the one thing that I knew would gain attention. Put my hand in my mouth and whistled loudly, and I got silence. So, and then I started. So the thing is, when they saw my attitude, you know, that actually, you know, I got their buy-in, and they started talking to me in a more structured manner, instead of going wildly, ricocheting off one subject to the other, having, you know, inside jokes and all that. Then it became a much more meaningful conversation, which the audience could relate to. So when it comes to more than one person, that's when it becomes even more challenging. And I realize I use a lot of aids to listen to people. For example, so when I'm looking at you, I know that this person here has just put his hand down. Now he's looking at me. He's got his hand crossed. Now he's looking away and he's now, okay, he's still looking at me. Right. So that's something which I've honed. So how do I use it in Coffee? So when I'm, even in a business meeting, so when I'm talking to somebody, my peripheral vision is on. So when my peripheral vision is on, I know when that person wants to say something. So when they want to say something, I like turn and say, was there something you wanted to say? No. So, you know, and then they feel that they are listened to. So I'd like to play a small video. I do understand that most of you, I mean, I don't know what percentage are Tamil speaking. So I would like to play a video to kind of show you this. This was from one of the videos on Coffee with Anu. One of my favorite videos, which is episodes. We had the very famous singer, Mr. S.P. Balasubramanian, and the music director, Mr. Gangayamaran. Mr. Gangayamaran is a very well-known music director, also the brother of Mr. Ilayaraja, the maestro. And we had them on the set. And with them, we had their sons. So we had S.P.B. Charan and Venkat Prabhu, who are stars in their own right. Okay, so they're there. But the thing is, S.P.B. sir and Gangayamaran sir have been friends since the time they entered the industry. Okay, so they are like very, very close friends from childhood, almost childhood. So, and they've maintained that friendship. That was what was beautiful. So the friendship is still there, and you can see that friendship. And what happens is, because they're having such a good time, they just completely took over the show. So they are playing with each other, pinching each other's cheeks and shouting, and you will see that they're like completely tripping and they're having a blast. But what is happening in the process is Venkat Prabhu and S.P.B. Charan are sitting right next to me and they're not able to participate, right? And what is my job? My job is to make sure that everyone, you know, gets to, that I include everyone in the conversation. So I have done something very clever, which is hyperlinking, but I don't know how to click it in this pointer. So someone come and help me, please. You use the touchpad. See? Okay, fine, the trackpad, I got it. So here it is. It should play, right? Yes.
கோவிலில் சேர்க்கலாம்.
Yeah. 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 Ye நீ மாட்டுற ஞாபகம் நிறைய பாடலை கொண்டு வந்தேன்னு சொன்னா ஜனங்களே
நீங்க பாடின அந்த பிபிஎஸ் சாருடைய பாட்டு நிலவே என்னுடைய
ஆடிஷன் சாங் கிடாது,
அது சரணத்துல இருந்து
சாப்பாடு போட்ட பாட்டு தமிழ்ல
சரணத்துல.
So what, if you notice, what happened is even in the shots that they show of SPB Charan and Venkat Prabhu, you'll see that he's got his mic, right? He's holding his mic. He wants to say something, but he doesn't have the opportunity to say. He's laughing. Yes, he's enjoying himself, but he's not included in the conversation. So you will know, you would have noticed that in between, I would have done a quick look like that and continued. And I'm laughing. I'm listening to what they're saying. But I know that he wants to say. So at that little gap, தமிழ் சொல்லுவோம்ல சைக்கிள் கேப்ல, ஸோ லைக் இன் தட் லிட்டில் கேப் தட் ஐ ஃபவுண்ட், ஐ டேர்ன் ரவுண்ட் அண்ட் சைட் ஐ ப்ரிட்டெண்டட் தட் யூ நோ வை டோன்ட் யூ இன்டர்வீன் ஸோ தட் வீ கேன் பிரேக் அப் திஸ் மாக் ஃபைட். ஸோ தி திங் தட் இஸ் ஹேப்பனிங் இஸ் எஸ்பிபி சார் டோல்ட் ஹிம் யூ ஹேவ் பிளேஜரைஸ் சம் சாங் அண்ட் ஸோ கங்கையமரன் சார் செட் ஹி பிளே சாங் அ ஹிந்தி சாங் அண்ட் தென் சாங் இளையராஜா சார் சாங் அண்ட் செட் வை யூ டெலிங் மீ அலோன். ஸோ தட் இஸ் வாட் வாஸ் ஹேப்பனிங் தேர். ஸோ இட் இஸ் I know the quality of the clip was a little poor, but what happens is then this includes Charan and it makes it easier to direct the conversation after that. So how is it useful in a corporate world? In many meetings, what we are trying to do is build a consensus, right? We are trying to build consensus. It makes it easier to build a consensus when people feel they are being listened to. As it is, consensus building is complicated, right? You have to defend your view, you have to defend your approach, you have to listen to what other people are saying and see whether you can, you know, somehow get a combination of approach that will work for everybody. It's complicated enough as it is, without having to add the resistance that is sure to crop up when someone feels that they are not being listened to. So it really helps when you make everyone feel that they are being listened to. My boss, who also happens to be my classmate from BITS, he tells me something which is very useful, because listening while you're in a conversation is very similar to listening when you are making a presentation. He always tells me that you should have, before you go to a customer meet, you should have your presentation and you should have three versions of it. One is a version that you'll finish in 10 minutes. I see my customers almost gone off to sleep. There's no point in going, you know, there is no relevance to him. I'll quickly finish it, if it's a cold call, obviously. The other is something that you can talk for about half an hour. And the third version is something that you can make into a half a day workshop. So when you go for a meeting, you have three versions. And which version I use will depend on the cues that I've picked up when I'm, you know, listening while I'm making my presentation. So there are times, okay, sometimes you do get your cues wrong, but it is more often than not you will know, do I need to cut short, do I keep going or not. The other thing that I would like to add is that it is not enough to just listen to what is being said. You need to be inclusive, yes, you need to listen to what is being said, but that is not enough. It's very important to listen to what is not being said. I really love this quote. I'm not sure if it's visible to the people at the back. It says, most people do not listen with the intent to understand. Most people listen with the intent to reply. Right? We are all guilty of that. Most of the time when I'm listening to someone, I'm, okay, what shall I say in response? And how can I be intelligent, come across as intelligent and smart and prove that I've understood? So I'm jumping one step, right? Because without trying to understand, if I've understood, automatically I'll know what to say. So, but listen to what is not being said is a lesson which was very useful for me. So now, one of the roles in my corporate job is I am the customer relationship manager for one of the global beverage companies. So as part of that, So then what happens is I interact regularly with both business and IT. And we make sure that we are delivering what we've promised. And do you have any issues that you think our company is not addressing? Do we need to address this? You know, the usual stuff that happens. So during one of our steering committee meetings, I'm there. And one of the ladies who is very clearly our company's champion and who has been our, you know, someone who has helped us throughout and advised us in this whole thing. Now, her conversation is only going towards closing report. And this project is finished. What about the closing report? Now, normally, she makes a mention about, you know, there are three other markets we are considering your company for, and they are the APAC markets, and, you know, their backend system is this, and we have this CRM, it's an SAP, or whatever it is. All that, some information used to come out. But in this call, she was not saying that. She only was talking about the closing report. And when I tried to guide the conversation back to what's a roadmap and, you know, things like that, she kept bringing it back. So I was a little concerned. Now, why is she not talking about the future roadmap? Is it that they are unhappy with the company? Is it that they've changed their plans for their company? What is going on here? So what I did was I took it offline. So I decided to talk to her. I called her up and say, hey, so how are things? And just wanted to check with you and what's our plan? Turns out that she's actually changing her role. So she's moving out of this role and going into another region-specific role. As a result, she's more interested in whether she's tied all the loose ends, right? She's finished. She's not interested in giving us new business. She's interested in, have I done a good job? My appraisal report, am I going to get a good rating? And now I'm moving on to Mexico. So that's where I'm going. So I'm not interested in Europe. So when I knew that, that was my cue to ask her, all right, who's your successor? And start building my relationship with the successor for the organization. For my company, the relationship has to be built with that successor. Because I listened to what she was not saying, I actually got a 2-month head start. I would have eventually found out that, oh, as of now, there'll be an official announcement, right? But in the corporate world, it is an advantage having that kind of a head start, because I could build an equation with a new guy, Didier, who came in, and I could, you know, set expectations. I could see what he's looking at, and it was, I already had a kind of relationship built before the public announcement was made, and that is an advantage. I think this might be a good time to stop for questions. I don't know whether you can read that. I love this. It says, now and then I announce, I know you're listening to empty rooms. If I'm wrong, no one knows. And if I'm right, maybe I just freaked the hell out of some secret organization. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to take them now. Yes, please. That's when you have to start looking like a like one of these magpies, right? That. No, the thing is, there are also sometimes when there are too many people, it's a great question, because when there are too many people, peripheral vision does not work. Because in this angle, if I've got three people, it's difficult to differentiate which movement is whose movement. So then what I do is, it is sheer observation. You have to observe. And you have to, when people are talking, you have to look at other people when they are talking and listen to them. So then you split your attention between your hearing, which is processing the information going into your head, and your visual, which is going to tell you who is being excluded. That's how I would do it. Do you think there's a better way? I don't know. If you do, happy to. Anything else, or shall I go on? Okay. This is very, very important. Cultural differences do matter. Remember when I started, I said, you know, Coffee with Anu is a South Indian show, so we have a South Indian approach to the way we ask questions. So in the corporate world, cultural differences make a hell of a lot of difference. You know, when I started working in BBC for their flagship show, EastEnders. Now, I've been working in India for 25 years. And I've been on film sets, so I'm no newbie when it comes to acting and film sets and television sets, right? But in India, a beginner doesn't really, he or she doesn't approach the director or hang out with the senior artists and all that. I don't know, has anyone visited film sets? You have. So have you seen the hierarchy that is there? Yeah. So have you seen that there are heroes, you know, the heroes have their own vans. And which film set did you go to? Pardon? Ah, okay, Arya, okay. One of Arya's films. Okay, so for the benefit of the others, see what happens in an Indian scenario is, all the senior artists have their own caravans or their rooms or whatever, and they keep to themselves. The junior, so to speak, junior artists don't go and sit beside the senior artists, the clear hierarchy. So if they are junior artists, then they'll sit in one on the other side. So there's a very clear segregation. So this is my experience, right? Now, even though I have been working in India for 25 years, as far as BBC and English is concerned, I'm a newbie. So what I did was I stuck to myself. I just sat quietly and, you know, I was miserable because I didn't know what in the world was happening. They had scripts and they had something called amendments and their reporting structure was different. So I was really miserable and I was lost and I was asking myself, what in the world am I doing? You know, I am like such a senior artist from India and look at me, all that, you know, the usual feeling sorry for yourself business. So yeah, I'm very good at that. So I was doing that. And then I said, okay, let me see what other people are doing. And I looked around and I noticed that most of these new and young artists, they don't have this thing about, oh, you are senior, I am junior, I won't talk to you. They don't have that. Everybody is on first name basis. And they do interact with people. They are respectful though. In India, if I'm a light boy, hey, come here. So that attitude is there. If I'm a director, sir, please come. That is there. I'm telling you it is there. I've seen it. So, but in UK, in the British industry, it's not there. They treat the light, I love that, you know. There is dignity of labor. They treat the light boy with the same respect that they treat the director of photography and the actual director. And a new actor can actually go up to a director and say, hey, you know, this is the scene. Do you think I can perform it this way? Do you like this? Can I do? So you can give your suggestions. So I said, okay, so this is how it is. Let me see if it works. And when I did that, I found that I made friends really quickly. And then there were people more than willing to explain to me what was happening. What is amendments? How do you, you know, amendment for a scene used to be this thick. And then the episodes used to be this thick. And then amendments would come. I don't know how to sync these two, all that. So they taught me all that. And I was much happier. And in the corporate world, again, how do I apply this in business? So I make sure that I understand the cultural differences to the extent possible. For example, when I hear a British, I've just said something, right? I've just presented a point of view. And I hear a British guy saying, that is certainly one way of looking at it. Do you know what he's actually saying? He's actually saying that is certainly the wrong way of looking at it. He is not, don't get too thrilled, he's agreeing with you. He's saying, that's certainly one way of looking at it. I mean, if he says that, then we know, okay, here comes our defense. Now let us be ready. Listen to what he's saying, because the point that he's going to make is the point that I'm going to have to defend or decimate, as the case might be. Right? And also British people are great for making small talk. And they just love having these inane conversations. But the thing about the conversation is that the most self-deprecating and funny you are, they like it. They like it when you make fun of yourself. The moment you go and say, oh, I come from this great family of great actors and we are all big stars and we are very talented, you just shut up and sit in that corner now. They're not interested. Right? So they don't like people being unnecessarily pompous about themselves. They are very self-deprecating. And the great thing about that culture is, even though they are self-deprecating, their confidence comes through. They can make fun of themselves, but nowhere will you question, is he sure of his capability? He's very sure about his capability. But that's just his way, right? But when it comes to Americans, it's very different. I've noticed in my personal experience with Americans, they don't really have time for small talk. They just get to the point. They want it quick. They don't like these long-winded presentations and talks, okay? But the strange thing about the American is, he would have met you only one day. Next day, he would have come and met you, and he'll say, how you doing, my friend? He'll come and put his arm around you. So don't get all warm and cuddly inside. He's not your friend. That's just his way of talking, okay? He doesn't mean much. That's just his way of talking. So I have seen this, like this coming from an American culture, they come to the European culture and then they go and try to hug. Oh, I've seen Europeans just cringe because Europeans are very big on personal space. They don't like all this. I mean, not unless they really know you. So and especially in a work situation, you don't go and hug your colleagues, right? So, well, you could. Depends on how the colleague looks, but. So, yeah. And you know, there are lots of differences. Like, I believe in Japan, it's considered beneath your dignity to go alone to a meeting. And I believe the guy who speaks the least is probably the most influential. So, you know, there are so many things to pick up, these nuances. And it is so nuanced that it's not really easy to pick it up. You'll need time to understand it. But let me tell you, if you are able to pick this up, if you can make the effort and you play this card in your conversation, then they accept you that much quicker, right? And it's very important because you need to remember a very, very important axiom. I always remind myself of this. People do not do business with companies. People do business with people. So if you're not able to build that communication bridge that communication gap because of your cultural differences, there you go. You've already got a disadvantage. And you have to remember that it is a global village that we live in, right? Because of technology, world has really shrunk in the digital age. And therefore, it is all the more important that you learn how to become a global citizen. And the most important aspect of being a global citizen is being able to have effective conversation in different global cultures. On one side, you're trying very hard to understand the nuances of all these cultural differences. Don't forget who you are. You know, that's another thing which I feel very, very important. I'd like to share this with you. You know, when I said that, when they asked me to do Coffee with Anu, they said, you come as a guest. And then they said, come as a host. Do you know what my reaction to that was? I said, look at the previous host. She's young and hot and fashionable and slim. I am none of those things, right? I have no delusions about that. So it's a visual medium. Why do you want me to be the host? They said, no, we just want a change. So you come, be the host. So I got into Coffee with Anu with no illusions about, you know, my, let's say my advantages or disadvantages or whatever, right? Okay, I talk well, I'm no slouch when it comes to conversation, and I think I'm reasonably intelligent, so I can kind of manage. But what happened was, I said, okay, what I'll do is I'll try to be myself. The only thing is I'll try to be the best version of me. I'll do the best. Let's see. And surprisingly, people liked it. And I would really strongly urge you to please do that, because you will be surprised how effective that the best version of yourself can be when you are out there in the world. The next host is also nothing like me. I mean it in the nicest sense. I knew it. I knew what you were thinking. I can hear all your thoughts. But the thing is, it is good because she's just being herself. And people like her also for that. You know, if Didi tried to be like me, she'll fall flat. If I try to be like Didi, impossible, right? So it works. And while we are looking at, you know, our image of ourselves, the other thing is our accent. Have you seen how a lot of people try and put on this accent? Any accent, as long as it's not my accent, it's fine. Yeddo or accent we'll put on, because we think it's hip and cool, okay? So I remember, I don't know how many of you would know. So there was this phase in Tamil television and radio, where we had these TV anchors and presenters talking Tamil in a really horrible accent. I don't know whether they're still doing it. So, you know, if there's a sentence that ungala paathu enak paathadhila enak romba sandoshama irukku, so they say enak ungala paathadhila romba sandoshama irukku, so oh enak konja tamil konja kashtam enak na try pandren. So, why, you know, my thing was, why are you doing it? And you know what, not many of them lasted. Right, they all had that small thing, and we even have singers singing in different. Well, let's not go there. Okay, so, so why have that accent? You know, I have had, you know, my colleagues come and put on accents. It's really funny. In a business meeting, you know, when someone puts a false accent, see, that's when my experience as an actor is really helpful. I'll tell you, as an actor, one of the most difficult things to do is to maintain a consistent accent. You know, I did the dubbing for a movie called Naladamayanti, where I speak Sri Lankan Tamil. Okay? Nobody knows how much of an effort it was, because I had actually written the entire dialogue in Sri Lankan Tamil and had prompted the actress, to Geetu, to talk in that thing, and then it's very, very difficult. So when in a business meeting, you're trying to put on this hip accent and saying, you know, in our Silicon Valley aspirations, we want to be the number one and everything that we do. It happens, I'm telling you. It'll just slip like that. And not only that, then they'll realize, oh my God, I've slipped up. And then they'll try and cover up. And what is happening in this? Who is suffering? The content is suffering, right? You're talking rubbish and your content is suffering and it's just a waste. Okay, I think this is a good time to tell you that if any of you hear any British accent coming from me, it's not me trying to impress the socks off this audience and trying to don this really awfully perfect British accent. It's not. It's just that I've been living in the UK and every now and then one pish-posh accent comes off in. So I don't know how that happens. But the thing is, if your content is good, you know what you're talking and you're making sense and you're prepared, it's fine. Forget about your accent. It really is irrelevant. Content is king. Your accent is one, many times an ineffective pawn who does more damage. Right. Do you want me to pause for questions? No? Okay. I will take that as a compliment. The other thing is, I say, always prepare. Prepare and have a script for every meeting that you go to. People might scoff at this attitude, but it's a great, great habit. People who have watched Coffee with Anu very rarely realize how much preparation went into it. So people actually look at Coffee with Anu and think, oh, Anu just goes on the spot and kind of talks. No. No. You know how it is? I had a team which would go and do research. They would go and research, talk to the guests who are going to come. They'll go and talk to the family, friends, everything, and get a lot of information about them. Okay? Using that information, I would create a rough script. Then I would share it with my director, Mohan, and he would give his inputs. And then together, we'll say, all right, this is fine as a script. So I would have a 40-minute script, and I used to learn it. I learned the 40-minute script. But what happens is, when you go onto the set and you start talking, the guests want to talk something else, right? You have an agenda. Very good. You keep your agenda. I want to tell you this. Okay? So you listen to me now. So that happens. So how do you handle this? What I used to do is, I always say I'm like a deft tailor, okay? So I do all this copy, cut, paste, and edit job on the spot. What happens, I have one box which has my script, right? Which I have prepared. That's my structure. That's a rough script. In another box, I start putting all the things that my guests want to talk. I start putting it in there. And then I do a cut, copy, paste, and I start editing on the spot, and I create the third script, which goes into the final box that the audience sees. And the reason that I'm able to appear spontaneous is only because I have a structure. It's not that I just go, chumma go and sit there and say, yes, come on, let's talk. It doesn't work, right? So it's easier for me to be spontaneous because I have a structure. I have this. So I do refer to it. Of course, in coffee, I used to be much better. This used to be here. But in front of IIT students, I got nervous. So I have a written script. So in all the hundreds of episodes that I've done in coffee, there was not one single episode that did not have a script. You know, it would be interesting when you, if you go back sometime and happen to notice, but it looked like there is no script. There is a script. I suppose this is a good time to quote that oft-quoted line, no? If you fail to prepare, you know that. Prepare to fail. So my approach to customer meets is no different. When I'm going for a customer meeting, I research about the company. I look at their annual report. You know, I see what their market presence is. I try and understand, do I know what their pain points are? Right? Do I know their roadmap? Do I know what their expansion plans are? Are there any articles in the news? Is there, has there been a merger or acquisition that I need to know about? Have they acquired a new business? Are they struggling with it? Are they thinking of divesting their business? You know? Is that my cue to dance? So, I always love that. I remember Dashavataram when Kamal starts dancing and then realizes it's his phone. So that's going to happen to me now. Next. So, what I do is I do my research and I go for the meeting. And that is my rough script, right? But prattling on about who you are and what you do, without speaking about how you can either bring in a top line increase or bottom line control or make a qualitative difference to the business, is of no use to the customer, right? And if you don't talk about that, it's a surefire way of putting him to sleep. And no one wants to know how good you are. They want to know how good you can be for them, right? So just going and saying, I'm the best there is in the world, no one gives a you-know-what. So I'll talk about that later. So and also, we didn't go for that meeting just to listen to what the customer has. Because like I said, in my second dabba, I've got what the audience, the guest wants to talk, right? We didn't go there just to listen to the customer. So when I go for the meeting, I also listen to the customer. I have my own agenda that I want to put. And then I do what I do, which is cut, edit, copy, paste. And I come up with a combination of this. And as I said, there are a lot of people who scoff at this approach. But to me, this approach is the difference between managing to do your job and being darn good at it. So remember, when you have a rough structure, as I said, it is easier to be spontaneous without losing the plot. How always do you think I've been sticking to what I wanted to say without losing the plot every now and then? I suddenly digress and say all kinds of things and then come back. It's only because I have this. The other lesson that I learned is that one-upmanship is not always a good thing. Okay? You know, as we go through life, we meet different caliber of people, right? Even in media, I've met some really rubbish actors. I met some superb actors, some great directors, rubbish directors. So you meet, and then you, in my corporate world, I've met some really, so censor. So I've met some people who are less capable than me, and there are people who are more capable than me. But it is important that you don't focus on that difference. Because when you focus on that difference, there are only one of two things that can happen. Any guesses? When you focus on whether a person is better than you or worse than you. Exactly. When you see that they're worse than you, you start getting overconfident and arrogant in your own capabilities. You're setting yourself up for failure. And if you see that they are, oh my God, they're so much better, then you start getting nervous. Right? So don't focus on that difference at all. As I'm fond of saying, be the best version of yourself. And of course, you know, I love to do one-upmanship. I'm a competitive person. Remember, you're looking at this woman who last year went and played laser tag You know what laser tag is, right? So that this laser tag, I had this mock gun in my hand, and I ran after an 8-year-old boy screaming, kill him, kill him, kill him, because if we shot out his laser light, my 26-year-old niece and I would be the winners. So we like, you know, I mention this because I am programmed to chase success, right? I want to win, as I'm sure you are as well. Thank you. Thank you. Frog in my throat. So I am programmed to win. I do chase success. And in the process, what happens? I immediately want to prove to everyone how much better I am. Correct? Do you get into that mode? That competitive mode where you want to prove how better you are, how much better you are. Now, the thing is, it is easy to prove that. But the most difficult thing is, how do you do that? How do you prove that you are very good without saying that that person is very bad? The answer? I don't know. I really don't know. And I think it's important that we find out. Because if we do have that, I think we've got a great asset on our hands, you know, because then one-upmanship is less negative for other people. So if any of you manage to discover that, please share that with me. I'd like, oh, yes.
I had a chance to work with you.
Yeah, I know. So we worked on a film in the UK, a Tamil film, which was produced and directed and executed in the UK.
He initially said that, you know, she is a famous actress. Is that not? So I was like, okay. But unfortunately, he doesn't know that we are LinkedIn friends. And when I met you on the shooting spot, like, you were like saying, hey, hi, how are you, this, that, and that kind of thing. Right? And he was like, wow, what happened?
Mm.
So that's a great compliment that, you know, whatever you said previously, that's what she is. Yeah, that's what she is. Like,
I know, especially if he's complimenting me, he has to speak into the mic, no? I'm telling you, Karthik, that's like, really, I set him up. No, actually, I didn't. But no one's going to believe me. But no, he just said something very nice about me, that I'm a nice person. Nallavaru, vallavaru, you know how they do that. So that's what it is. But thank you, Karthik. No, really, it's a nice thing for you to say. I do hope. No, there is a bad side to me. To be honest, I'm extremely short-tempered. And if you flick the wrong switch, I can be nasty.
I have
nasty.
That as well for you. I mean,
I am nasty. Yes.
Sometimes.
Yes. I am really nasty.
I had that.
You had that. Well done. See, I'm very, if nothing else, I'm honest. Nothing else, I'm honest. Because see, it takes a lot of courage. Let me tell you something. It takes a lot of courage to stand in front of you guys and say, okay, he's just complimented me. Okay, yeah, I'm good. But it takes a lot of courage to tell me, yeah, guys, I'm very happy that someone sees the good side in me, but I have a nasty side as well. And I say that because I'm trying to work hard, trying to kind of balance that out. Because that nasty side has got me nothing but grief. So it's an useless side. But I think he would just use that as an opportunity to make me feel nice, so I shall not question that. What do you think? Good approach? No, it didn't. It didn't. It didn't. So, because nobody has that answer. You don't have that answer, because when you're trying to do a one-upmanship, you will end up proving that the other person is crap. It will happen many times. At least in my experience, it has happened. Unless it is not a direct comparison that we are doing. And suddenly you are in an isolation. Suddenly we are saying that, oh my God, she sings beautifully. That's fine. Okay, so, but if someone does find out that, as I said, please do let me know. Now, the points that I've made so far are applicable to the external world. Like when you're customer facing, when you're with your, you know, customers and in the customer constituency. The next top point that I'm about to make is particularly applicable to within your organization. You notice I stopped myself at one point. See, unparliamentary language in a business environment is not cool. And it's certainly not necessary. And more often than not, it will land you in hot water. Especially in the international scenario that you are all likely to be. Yeah, with friends, it's no big deal because I know, see, I've also been in college, although it is kind of unbelievable. But yes, I've been in college where the closer the friends, the more ear singeing the greetings used to be. Are they? All that, yes? So it was an expression of how close I am to you if I said, hey, you. So, yeah, but in a professional environment, it's not appropriate because, besides, you do not have to be friends in a... See, that's another mistake which I've seen lots of people make. I want to make friends at work. No, you don't have to make friends at work. You just need to have a great working relationship. And if you have a good working relationship, there is every chance that it will become a proper friendship. You know, the other way doesn't necessarily work. I am your friend. Will you tolerate my incompetence? No, not happening, right? So the other thing is, you know, my friends who know me for a very long time know that I do not curse, okay? In the sense, yeah, I do say damn and crap and shit and all that stuff, but I don't say the F word, the C word and all that. I don't. And my cussing skills kind of, is limited to within that. And my logic is very simple. I said, I'm eloquent enough to tell you to go, without having to actually use the word. So basically I'm a prude, okay? So I'm just a prude. But it actually saves me because when I don't use unparliamentary language, I'm playing it safe in an international setting. Because you will realize quickly, very, very quickly, that there are very clear boundaries that are in place in a professional setting in an international organization. Like in India, you might be able to get away with it. UK, US, all these Western countries, you won't be able to get away with using unparliamentary language. And also the other thing is, oh, this is very, I really believe this. When there is a heated argument in a professional setting, and believe me, there will be lots of such heated arguments. When you use profanities or unparliamentary language in that kind of a situation, you are proving two very important things. One is that you are not in control of the situation. More importantly, two, you're proving that you're not in control of yourself. In a professional setting, it's very important that you do not display these two weaknesses. Because when you do display this, even the most powerful argument gets weakened by this. And you don't want to use unparliamentary language in a workplace and get into trouble and end up in a situation like what you're going to see now. No virus, I promise. Promise thane pannidalam.
I think given the unfortunate events of that night, my client simply wishes to ask about the timeline. Who said what, when? Just for clarification.
Of course, that makes sense.
Sure. Okay.
Yes. Thank you. I know this is difficult, but we've established the events of the afternoon when you gave that file to my husband, Mr. Best. I think you could argue that he took it with the intent to steal, and I'm sorry for that. And then that night he attempted to contact you?
That's right.
But there doesn't seem to be any mention of your meeting that afternoon.
My meeting with him?
Yes, that's right.
That same afternoon, I don't know. I saw him in the car park.
He said that you had a conversation on the staircase, on the stairwell at the back of the Norton building that leads to, I forget the name.
West Bridal Street?
Yes, that's right.
I'm sorry, I don't understand. What conversation?
The conversation you had with my husband.
No, not that day.
Then perhaps you can explain. Sunil said that you met him on the stairs and that you accused him of being a thief and he denied it.
No, that didn't happen.
We could just finish.
But it didn't happen.
Henry, thanks. He said that you were angry and that's understandable. He said he offered to sit with you, have a cup of tea, coffee, but he said, I'm not sitting down with a filthy, parky thief.
I did not.
He said, that's not fair. And he said, I'm going to get you sacked, you stupid thieving turban.
I did not. No, you can't write that down. I never said it.
Henry,
no, I'm not having it. Don't even try. Listen, my own boyfriend's black.
Oh, yes. The boyfriend's relevant too, because Mr. Best accused my husband of being an ugly, retarded breeder. We did not know what that word meant until someone told us that that's a derogatory term that homosexuals use to refer to heterosexuals. Mr. Best called my husband a breeder. He called him Appu. He called him Mowgli. And then, when my husband was very upset, Mr. Best told him to shove a poppadom in his mouth and fuck off back where he came from. That's what he said. I'm used to a Mac. I've forgotten how this works from current slide, yeah? Okay. So, yes, that was a scene from, I don't know how many of you are familiar with Doctor Who on BBC. Russell T. Davies was a person who turned it around. So it was his series. And yes, did I tell you that I do not use bad language? You think I lied? No, that wasn't me. That was Shuna Mirchandani, and she was actually repeating what that guy had said. So 2 degrees of separation and all that. But you know, I still had a lot of difficulty delivering that dialogue. I used to, when I had to do a rehearsal, so when I saw the script, I went, I have to say this. And then I showed it to my friends and they had a field day. They said, Anu, do you want to practice? Come on, let's practice. Let's hear you say it. Say it, all that was happening. And I said, yeah. And he told him to shove a poppadom in his mouth and I'll pause. Okay, because I couldn't get it. But then it's surprising what can happen when someone says action. So then I said it. So my friends make fun of me. So yeah, she doesn't use unparliamentary language. But the first time she decides to use it, she'll do it on national television when millions of viewers are watching, right? So the thing is, yeah, I guess that's something I'm going to have to live it down, but I don't think I'm ever going to live it down. But the thing is, the example that I was trying to prove is that, you know, in the UK and in the US, this will make him lose his job and he will be sued if he's, you know, he used unparliamentary language. In this case, she's lying, but yeah. And with that, allow me to say thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being such a fabulous audience. And thank you for listening to me. And I really, really enjoyed talking to you. I'm done unless you have questions.
Yeah, we are taking questions now. Please put up your hands and the mic will come to you.
My question is, in your whole presentation, you turned all your weaknesses into strengths. I mean, it was basically like what could be like in the first point you told, like, if you don't know something, you can turn it into a strength as such. What is one weakness which is still there, which you are not overcome and able to turn table and form it as your strength?
Yeah, that's a great question. See, my weakness is, I am extremely organized. Right? For example, as a line producer, when I was, I needed to know everything. What time will you start? What time will you finish? And all that. You know what my weakness is? My ability to tolerate sloppiness. You can't, and one of the mistakes that I do is I go on pointing out, you make mistake, you're doing this. It doesn't endear me to anybody. That is a big weakness that I've got. And this tendency to nag at weaknesses is something that I'm working on and trying to become a little more accepting of, you know, other people, that they function differently, they get the result, that's fine, you don't have to stick to this. Does that answer your question?
Hello, ma'am. How do you do like many things at the same time? You listen, or you also watch other person is doing the reactions. You also run your script at the back. So how do you multiprocess at the same time? Means I'm very bad at it.
You know
how
what?
To practice
I don't look at it as multitasking. I look at it as unitasking at each stage. So when I'm talking to you,
I'm only talking to you, right? But if my main task is actually conducting a conversation, that's when I demonstrated that peripheral thing, right? Then my main task becomes something else. So it doesn't come like, yeah, that's something that has perplexed me as well. But I don't look at it as multitasking. When you look at the bigger picture, right? I draw, I write, I work for a company, I act, I'm a co-producer in an English movie, I'm acting in, okay, all that stuff. When I'm doing one thing, I'm only focusing on that. So when I am talking to you right now, I'm not worried about Her Majesty Revenue and Customs, tax returns which have to be done for my company, the corporate tax return that has to be done, I have to sign it. I'm not thinking about that because right now, I have to focus. I think focus would be how I handle it. I prioritize my activities and focus on what needs to be done now and compartmentalize that which needs to be done later. Good, I never thought about it that way. Yeah, I actually do that. Thanks. Yes.
Good evening, ma'am. Actually, I want to ask, why did you quit acting and switch to corporate world? And how did you do and manage all these things? And what is the motivation behind this to switch from acting to corporate world?
Well, you are wrong. I haven't switched. Okay. I continue acting in the UK. I'm acting on a television series in BBC. I have currently agreed to do a role in an English movie. I have just finished a Malayalam movie and two of my Tamil movies are waiting for release. So, I haven't quit, although it looks like I have. What I have quit is television. What has happened is it has made it logistically difficult for me to live in the UK and work in television in India because as they are like, they do a lot of last minute filming. And enmo bussa pidichu Guduvanjerik vara madri, I can't come from London to Madras, right? So television becomes a little challenging for me. But my life has always been on parallel tracks. Right from the time I started acting in Indra. When I was acting in Indra, I was working in Thermax in human resources. And then I continued running my business and then I continued acting. So I've always had that parallel track. So at any given point of time, I will be having one business or a corporate version of me and one actor, TV presenter version of me. Neither are nice. Yes.
You were talking about living in a global village. Yes, I do agree with that. We live in a global village. We meet different kinds of people from different countries. But you learn how people from different countries behave only when you interact with them. So the first time you interact with them, you are prone to get embarrassed. Do you have any ideas or how do you prevent such embarrassments? Like, do you read about them? How many books did you read?
I have a very good friend called Mr. Google.
But Google, it could be very generalizing and you cannot...
No, not necessarily. Mm-hmm. Try and search the 10 things that British say that Americans misunderstand.
So before Google, you were in a generation that was...
No,
Google.
No. Busku. No. I was there.
You were. What did you do?
Okay, let's look at a hypothetical situation. I don't have internet connection. Okay, let's say that. That's a little more complimentary than saying you were in a generation before Google. All right? Okay. So what I'm saying is, let's look at that. It's a nice thing. It's like a challenge that I would take. Observe. You tend to observe. You have to observe. You will get embarrassed. But there are some common rules that can be applied. Less is more. When you're in a strange situation, no, don't blabber too much. Minimize what you're saying. Just say one thing, look at the cue, see how the reaction is going, tread very cautiously. That is the only solution you have. And I've been in a lot of unfamiliar situations. Honestly, this is the first time that I'm sitting and doing a presentation for an audience of students of this intellectual caliber and... Good, am I not? Good. Anyway, so observation. I would say observation is the only thing. But the other thing is thick skin. You get embarrassed, okay. Get embarrassed. Now also don't just forget what lesson you've learned after you've gotten embarrassed. Forget the embarrassment, remember the lesson.
Over here, madam. So what I inferred from your first part, from the first part of your, what you said is, when in Rome, do as the Romans do. So is it right what I inferred?
To some extent, without losing your own identity, yes.
Yeah, that's what...
because acceptable cultural things, I meant.
Because sometimes what we portray ourselves wrongly and we end up faking ourselves. So how do we tackle that problem?
No, I'm not talking about losing your own identity, right? I'm just talking about simple things like, don't go and say, hey, how are you, da? Kind of thing to a European, you know, those kind of things. So you don't really lose your identity when you don't do that, do you?
No, but that means that you have to judge a person first before talking to them, and then
you have to get an idea of the culture first.
Yeah, that's what.
Yeah, yeah, you have to. And when you are and it's not, see, it's the nuances, the fine nuances are, you know, for example, because I spent a lot of time in the British thing, there is a very cute expression that they've got. Okay, do you know what that means? That means they are exasperated and they are angry with you. So the British way of saying I'm angry with you, that, you know, somebody will be standing in the entrance to the door you want to go out by, and that, what will we do? Say, excuse me, and push him and walk. Correct? Try doing it in Britain. They'll give you dirty looks and say, they'll do that. So now you learned what you should not do. So, but what I'm saying is, it is only by experience, and what he said is very right. You are bound to get embarrassed. But learning what is acceptable in a culture is not the same as losing your own identity and forgetting where your roots are. I would differ there. Oh, yeah. Without the mic, he said, and the moment you turned, he lost his voice.
Well,
no, I said people do business with people.
Yeah, not with company.
It's not just the company that they do business
but,
with.
But if people do business with people, how they can do without losing their identity?
Because, hey?
Yeah, because if some, because I met two days before, I met my friend. He's a salesperson. He's a marketing person.
Okay.
He doesn't have any habits. He is unique in his identity. Like, he won't drink, he won't smoke.
Okay.
He suddenly said, the moment I enter into salesperson, I met opposite company salespeople. They used to smoke and drink. I have to do that. Then only I can get business. He is telling in that.
Do you believe that he's confident of his capabilities, or do you believe he believes in the cigarette?
He doesn't. He won't get order from the client.
I'll tell you something. I don't drink. I don't smoke. I don't do dope. I mean, that is because people say I was born drunk and stoned. But the point is, you know, I don't do it, and I do have to socialize, and I am in situations that you talk about, especially in a Western culture. I am in situations where everyone has a wine glass in their hands. It's not a moral issue for me, okay? I don't say that it's a morally wrong thing to do. It's not that. I don't do it. I don't find it, in any way detracting from my ability to build a relationship with the customer simply because I don't drink or smoke. So I think it has to come from the confidence in your abilities and realize that standing like this doesn't necessarily mean you're cool. I think if you have the confidence, it takes time, I agree. This is what we have in schools and colleges as well, right? All my friends are doing this. Are you also? If I don't do it, then I'm not cool. So it sounds like that. I think he needs to grow up. He does, I'm sorry.
Well,
here. Yes.
Last bencher.
Yeah, I was also that only. Mm-hmm. I loved it.
In India, we also have some sitcoms and talk shows and stuff like that. And Coffee with Anu, or for the matter, Suchi or Didi, has come to some level kind of a thing. Why have we have not got a show of that merit like Oprah Winfrey show and stuff like that, which has become a legacy to
cult.
Look forward to? And when you say that this is going to be the last show, then the whole world feels bad that they are not going to see Oprah at all.
kind of a thing. So what it takes to become that kind of a show? Why India has not produced that?
I have my own pet theory about that, you know. Because when I was doing coffee, they used to tell me, you know what, you should do a show like Oprah.
Yeah.
And you know it'll work and all that. You know why my pet theory? Again, I feel it's a cultural difference. We don't like washing our dirty linen in public, no? To a certain extent, we are more inhibited, right? And if you look at it, there are only a large portion of our population is middle class, correct?
Yeah.
The people who are willing to talk are either the lower class who have nothing to lose. So you've seen how they talk. Okay? They are able to talk like that because they are in that zone, right? And the really super rich can talk because they can get away with anything. The bulk of our audience or people are middle class and we are extremely, extremely inhibited. So really coming and revealing ourselves and our problems, I feel, is a bit difficult. But on the other hand, Oprah also does a lot of positive stuff. I've seen some of her shows. She does a lot of positive stuff. And I have actually given ideas to channels saying that let's do something like that. Unfortunately, they believe it won't sell. They think they won't get the ratings, they won't get the money. So, I don't know. They say only as long, television nowadays, they're saying is celebrity driven. So, if we have a cinema star, then they're getting the ratings. Cinema star illana, not, which is why, you know, in all these things, you will have one celebrity or the other coming in. So, it's a change that needs to come from the television channel. And also to see if we can kind of get over that cultural inhibition that we've got. Good evening. I beg your pardon? They give what? Shares. Okay. Yes, negotiation. So you're talking about negotiation, right? It's too wide a subject. So I would probably want to know what is that company, what can I give the company, and therefore what can I get in return. Yeah, I would see what benefit I can give to the company. And I know, so I will use that to get, hey, there is no one-way traffic, huh? You have to give something to get something. So unless you have value, you're not going to be able to negotiate the best deal. So you'll have to see how you can present your advantage and what good you can do for them. And then say, therefore, in return, I would like this. That's how I've been doing. It works. Yes. You're from St. Joseph's. How has being a... Okay, so I think in school, what I loved about school was that they used to encourage me to do everything. Like go play basketball, go do shot put, go do long jump, go do sports and all that. So I believe that this ability that, you know, when one of them asked me, I think you asked me, when you said, how do you multitask? It's because they taught me the ability to enjoy many different things. Without saying, you must only study, you must only study, you must get first rank. They didn't do it. So I would say that was a great, you know, advantage that I got from St. Joseph's. So, yeah.
Hi, Anu.
Sorry, yeah.
So I have to ask this question because you're a celebrity. Like, you're famous because, I don't know if it's because of your Hasan, but you're kind of famous. But people...
people see Thank you for putting me in my place. I like it.
People see you with something greater than them. So they will not come and mingle with you like normally.
No.
You have not faced it at all.
No. I'll tell you something. You know, I'm somewhat famous. People kind of somewhat know me. And when I go on the road, somewhat they recognize me. But what they do, you know, no, it's very strange. When I would love to share this this incident with you. I think it makes sense to you. So I was sitting with another actress. We were shooting. We were both sitting together. And all of them came running. And they said, autograph, madam, autograph. So they got her autograph. They saw me. And they said,
younger வீட்டு பொண்ணு மாதிரியே இருக்கே. That means you look just like our daughter, you know. And I was like, what? I mean, you got autograph from her alone, you're like doing this. And then I realized that's a compliment. They look at me as one of them. I do not get treated as a star or a celebrity. And one of the things, you know, it's true, I'm glad I don't, because I think you lose touch with reality when someone starts telling you that you're fabulous, because you start believing it and it's not true. So, yeah.
Hello, ma'am. Hi.
Yeah. Yes.
Ma'am, when you continue interacting with somebody, it matters that we ask questions to them about them, and also you got to keep their interest about you also going so that the conversation follows.
Yeah.
So how do you strike a balance between the two, and how much does eye contact matter in this, like, to continue the conversation going?
I'll split it into two parts, my answer, okay? Because one answer is common, the other answer is specific to me, okay? So let me tell you about the first bit, which is how do you ask questions about that person and how do you maintain their interest in you? I try to relate. You know, when I try to talk to you and you're telling me something, you know, when I, like, for instance, when that gentleman who used was there, who's run off. So when he asked a question about how do you negotiate, and I say immediately, I try and say, you know what I do? This is what I do. So I try to relate. I try to see what similarity can I find with what you're saying, and I'll put it across there to you and then wait for you to pick up the cue and start talking about that. That's what I do. That's what works for me. As for eye contact, it's a very, very strange thing for me. When I make a focused eye contact with somebody, they get nervous. They do. So when I'm acting, I try not to make any straight eye contact at that person and look into that person's eyes, because they'll forget the dialogue. So I have now developed a pattern where I do a scanning mechanism. If you watch me when I talk to somebody, I will look eyes, nose, mouth, look away. I do that. Maybe it makes me look a little furtive, like I'm going to run away with the family jewels or something. I don't know. but that's what I do. And it's very important that I do not. And let me also confess, when I'm trying to intimidate someone, I do that steady look. It works.
Check.
I have the next.
Ma'am, and what has been your stint with basketball? Because I read your bio that you're a basketball player.
Yeah. I should be a pivot. I'm also very good at defense, because everyone makes fun of me and says I use all my colory moves in basketball. So I like stand there with, you know, I put one hand up, one hand down, and I'm in one colory pose. I'm extremely stable. So and I'm solid and big. So.
Sorry, I have the mic and the next question.
Yes.
To your father.
I don't know where, who. Yes, left, yeah. Hello.
So, for all the nuanced approach to communication and soft skills and all the rules that you put on the slides, in practical scenario, in the experience that I've had and some of the movie situations that I've seen, most often it sounds counterintuitive, but if you break all those rules, that's when you seem to have a certain success with people, because you have all these sheep in a corporate environment following all these rules, trying to be docile and, you know, trying to be polite and things like that. And then you have this tiger who walks in. If you've seen movies like The Wolf of Wall Street or you know, any of those movies which talk about the stock market, you have this hitch, for instance, where he proposes to the chairman of the board. So I'm saying there are scenarios where all these rules, you know, you can throw them out and still be successful and effective when you communicate and make a mark outstandingly.
Yeah, yeah. So and your point is...
How do you reconcile that?
Sorry?
How do you reconcile that? Why haven't you...
I don't have to, because see, the thing is, I'm talking about my lessons and what works for me. Right? And if someone can break those rules, then I believe that they are succeeding despite it and not because of it. I honestly, like for instance, one of the very strong rules that I firmly believe in is there's no cause or reason to be rude to someone. Okay? There's no reason. You don't achieve anything by being, you can be firm. There's a difference between being assertive and aggressive. I choose assertive. That's what I'm saying. And you are right. I am sorry if you thought these were rules. They were not rules, they were lessons. Right? These are lessons that worked for me. And I hope that some of them would have resonated with you, and you know, sometime in your life you might be able to use it. But what you said is also true. Sometimes rules are there to be broken. These are not the rules, these are the lessons and guidelines. And you know what? I didn't show you the last slide. You know what my last slide says? When I say thank you, it says, thank you, this is me. Nobody can tell me that I'm doing it wrong. So just be yourself. So there won't be any rule, there won't be anything wrong. And if you are clear in your vision as to what you want to go after, whether it is your the company board's president whom you're going to propose to, or yeah, whatever it is, if you're clear and you know how to do it, go for it. Yeah. Shouldn't we be asking him that question? Yeah. No, but what I'm saying is, see, these are all lessons that everyone has to learn. You know, see, what do we hope to achieve by me coming here and telling you something? It's not like I'm giving you a bottled version of, you know, what all lessons I've had in all my 45 years. Yes, I'm 45 years old. So it's not that the bottled version of something, some secret that I'm coming and giving to you. It's just that I'm saying that this might be useful to you, but you know what? Do you remember I said, if you find out how to do this, tell me. I want to know. I really meant it, because you will have lessons which would be useful to me or other people. So he will learn. I'm sure he's going to learn. Pity he missed this question. I wonder how he would have answered it. That would have been fun.
Hi, ma'am.
Yes?
There might be many situations where our personal emotions come into the corporate world. Like, there might be something inside feeling, and yeah, you have to go and attend the meeting and convince them, but it will not be like, you cannot put your best always, but the corporate world will not stop for you.
No.
The same thing happens here, the classes will not stop for us. How could we manage that?
The show must go on. That's what I would say. The show must go on. You have to, I mean, it's difficult. You know, and sometimes you crumble, right? Sometimes when really something really horrible happens, you crumble and you stop functioning. Yes, that does happen, and that's life. But you make a choice when you will crumble and when you will not. Right? Do you crumble because you stepped on a nail, or do you crumble when there's a great tragedy in your life? That's a choice you make, and you can make that choice.
Good evening, ma'am.
I only hear one asariri vaku. Yes.
Did you feel by any chance your cookery show didn't pull off as much as your coffee show?
Definitely.
What would be the reason for that in your perspective?
Because obviously people like to see me talk and make other people talk, and people don't like to see me cook and enjoy my own food.
See, I had a remark for you in that show. I felt like you were kind of Peter in that. You didn't reach the chunk of middle class society that you intend to serve for the show to be a success. I mean, having known all those things, why did you do the other way?
It was meant to be a Peter show. Really, really it was. Because we had Chef Ivar, Chef Damo, correct? He was already doing that. There were other people doing lots of cookery show. Then there was that Star Cookery or something, Star Samayal or something, which was all doing. What was not there? Western dishes were not there. Okay. That's why I did it. Okay. So, and you know what? One of the things, they call me Mary Jane, because they think I'm very Western. But actually, I'm not really very Western. I'm a little confused, I think.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. But it was meant to be a Peter show. Yeah.
One last question. When did you discover your passion for writing, and why is the name of your book Sunny Side Up?
Yes. So I started writing about when I was 9 years old. So I started writing poetry and all that. And the other thing that happened was, then about 8 years ago, I was asked to write a column for a magazine, and I continued writing about life. And you know, and I, as you would have probably realized by now, I am the kind of person who really loves to laugh at myself. I find myself very funny. So I write in that tone, And then it was suggested, why don't you write a book? It's done rather well. Thank you for bringing that up, because I thought, you know, if I make it available, if someone's interested, please do take a look at it. It was published by HarperCollins, and it did rather well. It's a series of vignettes from my life. And there are these little quotes that I have which explain what lesson I've learned from that particular incident. For example, one of the things I say is, if your memory is not really good, then honesty is the best policy. Right? You know, things like that, which is what I feel applied to me, because I don't, you know, I don't not lie because I am like big Harishchandra family. I have a rotten memory. I lie, I'll forget, and then I'll get caught. So might as well tell the truth and, you know, just be safe. So things like that. So there are lots of, I talk about divorce. I talk about not having money. I talk about a whole lot of things. So that's there in my book. And if any of you is interested in getting a copy, and if you do happen to get a copy, I would really, really love your feedback.
Ma'am, what are your future plans for writing after Sunny Side Up?
I've been asked by HarperCollins to, I've been discussing with HarperCollins about writing fiction. They asked me to write a love story. And I thought, Anu Hasan writing love story somehow doesn't, you know, that doesn't gel, right? So I said, okay, let me see. I'm thinking of writing a kind of a family saga. I'm thinking of it. I don't know whether I'm going to be able to do it. I'll give it a shot. And then see whether I get rotten tomatoes thrown at me or not.
For those of you who are interested, the book is available outside. So you may want to purchase it, you can take it. And thank you, ma'am, for spending your time here. Quite had an insightful lecture.
Thank you.
May I now request Professor Preeti Agalyam to present a memento to our guest for the day.